There's nothing more exhilarating than pointing out the shortcomings of others, is there?
This video was made possible due to those who support me on Patreon. Thank you all for your support.
See, what you need is some jokes. Women love jokes.
Okay, you got any?
What do you call cheese? It's nachos.
What?
Nacho cheese. It's yours if you need it.
Absolutely not. That's a funny joke. Thank you.
Half Nelson was released in 2006, written by filmmaking duo Ryan Fleck and Anna Boden, and directed by Fleck. Despite being highly acclaimed in critic circles, earning Ryan Gosling his first Academy Award nomination for Best Actor at only 26 years old, the film didn't receive the widespread notoriety I feel it is more than deserving of. I only became aware of the film thanks to a YouTube video of an episode of At the Movies with Ebert and Roper, with guest host Kevin Smith, where he and Roper praised the film, with Smith going so far as to say it was one of the best films he had seen in the last decade. Upon watching the film, it immediately became, and remains, one of my favorites. Not just because of the exquisite writing and powerhouse acting, but because of its brilliant deconstruction of what is referred to as the White Savior Trope. For those unfamiliar, the White Savior Trope, or narrative, is roughly characterized as a story with a white protagonist, or primary character, who rescues non-white characters from their downtrodden circumstances. Now, some of you may ask, what is wrong with a story of a white person doing something nice? And, in and of itself, nothing. Some films that could be said to employ the white savior trope are even acclaimed masterpieces. No, not you. Not you.
How about pizza?
I'm down with that shit, my brother.
Hell yeah. However, the issue is how the majority of these narratives are framed, often having the experiences of non-white characters being told exclusively through the eyes of a white character. This effectively restricts the non-white characters to thematic devices, whose purpose is to facilitate a change within our white protagonist. Even when the narratives are adapted from true stories, changes will often be made to establish a white savior character who takes it upon themselves to defend the non-white characters, giving white viewers a character they can relate to that grants them the leeway to say, hey, I'm one of the good ones like them, not an evil racist one, which is why the attempts of many white savior narratives to tackle racial issues are often quite reductive, framing bigotry as something that is perpetuated primarily by individual acts of malice as opposed to systemic inequality. Now, while not every white savior narrative checks all of these boxes, the vast majority of tales that employ the white savior trope, even when adorned with a sincere, well-intentioned bow, have a common element. The perpetuation of the idea that would it have not been for the intervention of our white protagonist, the non-white characters would never have been able to escape their circumstances. It is this underlying insinuation that stands as the main point of contention many have with narratives of this kind. These stories implicitly frame one party as savior, the other as needing to be saved, ergo, incapable of saving themselves. At first glance, Half Nelson appears to fit the white savior trope to a T. The film tells the story of Dan Dunn, played by Gosling, an inner-city Brooklyn middle school history teacher and girls' basketball coach who attempts to protect one of his pupils, Dre, played by Sharika Epps in her astounding screen debut, from the clutches of neighborhood drug dealer Frank, played by Anthony Mackie. On the surface, the setup seems comically condescending. A righteous white teacher sets out to save his underprivileged black student from the cold, corrupting streets. That is, until we learn a dark secret about our protagonist, namely his addiction to crack cocaine. In most white savior narratives, the key incident is marked by our savior coming face to face with the obstacles that the non-white characters are subject to, followed by their decision to take on the burden of rescuing them from their turmoil, where they witness the harsh conditions those they set out to save exist in, which they set forth to rectify, where they bear witness to an injustice against the underprivileged they cannot let stand. But Half Nelson turns this on its head. Following a basketball game, Dan reconnects with his ex-girlfriend Rachel, a former addict herself. Upon seeing Rachel, making him reflect on his own failed attempts at rehabilitation, Dan soothes his despair by getting high in the girls' locker room, only to be discovered by Dre. The next day, Dan is an anxious wreck. assuming Dre told his superiors of his drug use. But to Dan's shock and relief, Dre has kept Dan's secret, thus beginning a trepid relationship between teacher and student. Instead of Dan bearing witness to Dre's troubles, it is the inverse. Instead of Dan taking on the burden of helping Dre, it's the other way around. In both circumstances, it is Dre who is the savior of Dan, so to speak. Following Dre keeping Dan's secret, the two form a friendship beyond their teacher-student dynamic, relating to one another as kindred outcasts. Unlike in most white savior stories, where the characterization of the non-white characters is revealed almost strictly through the perspective of our white protagonist, if they are given any at all, Dre is fleshed out entirely separately from Dan's lens. We learn she lives with her mother, who works long hours, as Dre's father is absent, and her older brother Mike is in prison for selling drugs for Frank, who is shown to look out for Dre, but it soon becomes clear he is manipulating her to become a dealer just like her brother. Dre is not merely drawn as a springboard for Dan to find self-fulfillment and enlightenment from. She is given a far greater amount of personal agency and is treated as a fully fleshed out individual with her own wants and needs. Upon learning of Frank's interest in Dre, Dan, obviously knowing who Frank is and what he does for a living, attempts to keep Dre away from his influence. However, in stark contrast to the valiant efforts of the competent white saviors of other films, Dan's efforts to protect Dre are ineptly ineffective, hindered by his own character flaws. In a pivotal scene, Dan directly confronts Frank, telling him to stay away from Dre. Your typical white savior narrative would frame this scene as our lead heroically going toe-to-toe and triumphing over their adversary, but Half Nelson once again subverts this cliche, as Dan's confrontation proves to be utterly incompetent, with him slowly coming to terms with just how powerless he is in this situation.
There's nothing to do with that.
No. It's good for Dre to have somebody like you looking out for, Mr. Model A1 fucking citizen.
I don't know!
The scene ends with Dan, who intended to tell Frank off, accepting a drink from him. Through Dan's desire to keep Dre from Frank, and his despair as he fails to do so, we gain insight into his philosophical point of view. Later in the film, Dan compares his attempt to help his students with his parents' participation in the counterculture movement of the 1960s. Dan muses that as an individual, he is powerless to make true change, at least to a substantial degree. This, however, blinds him from the fact that even small gestures of kindness and empathy, though they may seem insignificant in microcosm, can in fact promote true change. In another scene, Dan is approached by the father of a former student, whom he is told is now majoring in history at university, but Dan is most likely too high to even comprehend what he is being told. Dan never seems to consider how his interaction with this student, despite how insignificant it may have seemed at the time, may have gone on to change the entire trajectory of her life. In a sort of meta sense, Dan has fallen victim to his own version of the savior narrative. The film features various fourth wall breaking asides of Dan's students recounting various moments in history, all of which were major significant events that made a lasting impact on politics and society. These asides establish Dan's philosophical preconception that only large-scale acts or movements can have any lasting impact, and everything else is inconsequential. Dan believes it isn't enough to just be there for Dre, to lend an ear, to simply give her a ride home. He must save her, absolve her of her woes, be her hero. But this is ultimately revealed as a fantasy, one that only exists in Hollywood narratives, of the righteous hero saving those in need, culminating in a victorious conclusion. And as he fails again and again to fulfill this narrative with Dre, his drug dependency begins to seep into, and put at risk, his personal and professional lives. This is perhaps the most subversive element of Half Nelson, the way in which Dan is not portrayed as uncorrupted by societal influence, but as someone who is just as damaged and at risk, if not more so, than those he wishes to help. While most white savior archetypes are portrayed as wholly competent, in some cases borderline flawless, Dan is anything but. His seemingly put-together persona in the classroom in stark contrast to his aimless, downtrodden existence elsewhere in his life. This contradiction that is absent from most of these savior narratives, but I would argue is inherent in human nature, is expressed in the film via Dan's dialectic approach to history that he teaches to his students, which, in short, is the process of logically trying to find truth by reconciling contradictory information and or viewpoints. And thus, the film's central thematic question is expressed. How can Dan save Dre when he can't even save himself? The film goes so far as to subtly frame Dan's protectiveness over Dre as self-serving and even condescending, as less about him sincerely wanting to look out for her and more about alleviating his own shame, to serve as his own quasi-redemption arc, which could be interpreted as a sort of meta-like jab at white savior narratives themselves and how they use the non-white characters as vehicles to serve the arc of the white protagonist and by proxy, alleviate the guilt of white viewers. The framing of Dan's protectiveness over Dre is in stark contrast to Dre's efforts to befriend Dan, as Dan and Dre bond, realizing that despite their differences, they both struggle with isolation and a lack of control over their lives. It is clear that Dre's attempts to get Dan to reflect on the severity of his drug habit is emitting from a place of sincerity. She is not out to save Dan, nor does her concern for him come from a self-serving place. While it at times seems like Dan views Dre as a project of some sort, someone he feels he needs to rescue, Dre merely sees Dan as a friend, someone she can relate to and help through his struggles, not by being his heroic savior, but by simply extending understanding, non-judgment, and the occasional corny joke. Despite Dre's attempts to reach Dan, Dan's inability to confront his own faults leads him down a destructive path, and to him keeping Dre at a distance, only making her more susceptible to Frank's manipulation. Dan's self-destruction eventually results in his superiors discovering his drug habit, and him cutting things off entirely with Dre, who ends up becoming a drug runner for Frank. The film's pivotal scene has our leads collide at each of their lowest points. While delivering drugs to a hazy motel party, Dre discovers the client is none other than Dan. Rather than Dan seeing the error of his ways and springing into redemptive action, saving Dre from her fate at the hands of Frank, he responds with solemn resignation, handing Dre the money for the drugs and watching as she makes her exit. The next day, Dre arrives at school and sees Dan's class has been taken over by another teacher, and it is here that the film reaches its true climax, marked by a decision made not by Dan, but by Dre. Dre leaves school and is approached by Frank, but she rebuffs him. She heads to the motel room where she encountered Dan the night before, and they reconcile, with the ending implying Dan will once again make an attempt at getting clean. In this case, the climactic decision of the story is not marked by Dan risking it all to rescue Dre, as he would in a typical white savior narrative. Instead, the agency is given completely to Dre. While it was their connection and Dan's attempt to help Dre that led to her forsaking Frank, in the end, it was her decision to do so. Dan was not her savior, she was her own. Just as the film has up until this point dispelled almost every major trope of the white savior narrative, the competent hero, the valiant selflessness of our so-called savior, robbing the non-white characters of their agency, the film's conclusion subverts the cliche warm and fuzzy feel-good ending found in most white savior stories, which often end with the main conflict of the story being resolved in a neat bow on top sort of way, where our protagonist succeeds in their goal, where it is cemented that it was them who saved the day, and things would have simply stayed the same had it not been for their intervention, their guidance, their sacrifice. It perpetuates the idea that the non-white characters of the story needed to be saved, that they could have never saved themselves. However, in Half Nelson, the struggles both Dan and Dre face throughout the film are not dispelled by the story's conclusion. Mike is still in prison, Dre's home situation has not become any less troubled. Both Dan's personal life and career remain fractured, and considering his previous attempts to get sober have failed, there is no guarantee this one will succeed. Yet despite this, connecting back to the theme of dialectics, the story's central contradiction is resolved. How can someone with so little control over his own life save another's? How can a young girl rescue a person who is meant to be the one to offer her guidance? And the resolution the film comes to is, they can't. Instead of the ending having Dan save Dre, as he would in the typical white savior narrative, or having Dan and Dre save one another, it dispels the entire concept of the savior narrative, of one party being superior to the other. The finale is framed as one in which two equals extend to one another friendship and support, not in an attempt to save each other, but rather inspire one another to save themselves.